Welcome. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad I'm here. We're thrilled that you're here. I was wanting to see the big screen, and that's not even up there. I mean, what is this one? I had this vision of my great video showing on. So glad that you're here today at LifeGate Church. We have a tradition, and we've done it for 32 years now. And we're going to do it again today, if you'll play with me. And what it is in the first century, when people would greet one another that were Christian, they would say, "The Lord is risen," and the people they were greeting would reply back to them in a loud, loud voice, by the way, "Yes, the Lord is risen indeed." And so they kept the resurrection alive and working inside of them. So we're going to do that. So when I say, "The Lord is risen," I want you to yell at me that the Lord has risen indeed. So let's do it. The Lord is risen! You did great. Let's do it again. The Lord is risen. Yeah. Now, here's what we're going to learn today. You see, I don't care what's dead inside of you. You've got dead hopes and dead dreams, but what God's going to do today, whether it looks dead, feels dead, smells dead, is dead, doesn't matter, because God is a God of resurrection, and He's going to raise something up in you today. Is that all right? Come on. Get with me now. All right. Now, I'm not going to tell you who I am. If you don't know me, that's okay. So I got you a paragraph there about all that stuff. I just want to get into the Word of God. Is that okay with you? Let's dive in. So we're going to talk about the resurrection, of course. It's Easter Sunday. It's Resurrection Sunday. But I want to go beyond just that. You've heard that before. I want to expand our thinking. I want you to go out of here with some different thoughts and some new thoughts and some fresh thoughts. And so the way I do that is I ask a couple of questions. So I want to just ask you a couple of questions. You know, like, what's Jesus been doing for 2,000 years since the resurrection? Any ideas on that? You know, was he just sitting up there twiddling his thumbs waiting to come again? What's he been doing? All right, and another question is, why the resurrection? Why did God raise Jesus from the dead? That may seem like a mute question to you. I mean, here's my thought. Okay, we are saved by grace through faith, correct? Not by the resurrection, right? Our sins are forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ. It's the blood, it's the precious blood that washes us from our sins. Is that correct? Not by the resurrection. So why the resurrection anyway? And what's he been doing for 2,000 years? But what I really want to hone in on is, why is it so important to God and so precious to Jesus that we continue to see him as a lamb, as looking as if he had been slain? Why? Is that his glorified body? Do you see him that way? Is that how you image Jesus Christ? As a beaten up, scarred up lamb looks like he's been slain? Is that how you image? See, people see him as a baby in a manger. But he's not a baby anymore, right? People see him walking the land of Palestine and Galilee and healing people, teaching people, delivering people, but he's not walking that land anymore. People see him on the cross, nailed up there. Roman Catholics still have him nailed up there on their crucifix. But he's not on that cross anymore. He's not in that tomb anymore. People see him resurrected and ascended, but he's not going to be resurrected ever again, and he's not going to ascend ever again. So what's this lamb thing? Does anybody ever see him as a lamb looking as if it had been slain? Does anybody see him that way? Well, the answers to the questions that I've posed to you, and many, many more answers, are in the book of Revelation. Now, we can find the answers there. Now, the revelation is a revelation of Jesus Christ. It's not a revelation of Antichrist. The word Antichrist is not in the book of Revelation. It's a revelation of Jesus Christ. And in here, we see four great visions that make up the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so what we've got to do is we've got to see him in these four ways, these four dimensions, to get a revelation of him, to have a revelation of him in our hearts. So the first revelation, our first vision that we have of him, is one of the Son of Man. And he's the Son of Man, and he's walking in his church. You felt him already today, or you should have, because he's walking in our church. He holds the angels, the seven stars, or the seven angels in his hands, and he sends forth and disperses the Spirit of God into the churches, and that's what you've been feeling today. So that's one way that we're to see him, a revelation of the Son of Man. A second way that we're to see him is what we're talking about today. It is the lamb, or a lamb, looking as if it had been slain. That's in Revelation chapter 4 through 16. Now, that's the biggest part of the revelation. But nobody ever sees him this way. Nobody has a revelation of a lamb looking as if it had been slain. And the third way that we're supposed to see him is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We hear about that a lot. He's riding through the nations with a rod of iron. King of Kings, Lord of Lords, in a red vestment. You know, as some of us are so worried and upset about our world today, it seems like it's falling apart. And, you know, what's going on in Pakistan? What's going on in North Korea? What's going on in Russia? What's going on in China? What's going on in the United States? You know, we're thinking, what in the world is going on? But I want to tell you something. It really doesn't matter who's sitting on in the office, because our God has the world in his hand. He is in control. You have peace about all of that. He's been taking care of that for 2,000 years, and he's got it under control, right? So those are three ways. The fourth way that we are to have a revelation of him is as the husband, the lamb's wife, the lamb's husband, the husband of the lamb's wife. There you go. I got it. So that's the way we're supposed to see him as well. That's the New Jerusalem that comes down out of heaven. That's not heaven. That's not where you're going. That is his wife. That's a picture of the church. Walls of jasper, gates of pearls, one street of gold, a river of life, a tree of life. He is the light thereof. It's precious to him. The church is precious to Jesus. He's protecting it. He's providing for it. And the very safest place that you can be right now and today is in his church. He will take care of you if you're in his church. So those are the four things, basic things, that he has been doing for 2,000 years. And one of those things that we really need to understand is this lamb, a lamb looking as if it had been slain. But who sees him that way? Who sees Jesus as a scarred up, beaten up lamb with holes in him, scarred up? Who sees him that way? And he had to be a lamb led to the slaughter, right? But who sees him in that way? So this is what I want to read right now. I want to read in the book of Revelation. And if you got your Bible or your app, or nobody carries the Bible anymore, but maybe you got your app, and you can turn, get there, scroll there, punch there. But you can get there in just a second. Revelation chapter 5 and verse 1, and I'll be there in just a second. I'm going to set it up for us. John is seeing these visions, and every time he has a vision of the Christ, all four times, he goes into the Spirit. And he has just come out of the vision of the Son of Man, and now he's about to go into the second vision, which is a lamb as if it had been slain. So he's there, and a door opens in heaven, and a voice says, John, come up here. It's the same voice of the Son of Man. And so John goes up into chapter 4 of the book of Revelation, and he sees the throne room of God. He sees the Ancient of Days in the throne. He sees the rainbow. He sees the 24 elders. He sees the creatures with the four faces, six wings, eyes all over, sea of glass. He experiences this. So he sees all of this. And then we start reading in Revelation in chapter 5 and verse 1. And it says, Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne, a scroll. Now, a scroll is a piece of parchment about 20 inches wide, about 30 feet long. It was rolled up. The scroll. And it was written on both sides. On both sides. It was fully written. The only other time that we find anything like this is in Exodus chapter 32, verse 15, when Moses went into the mount and he came back down and he had the law of God. It was written on both sides. So what we're talking about here, what we're dealing about with here, is a covenant. It's this new covenant. It's the covenant that you and I are living in. So this is what we're talking about here. It was written on both sides. It was and sealed with seven seals. So it's fully sealed. It's fully written. The seals, seven is so important. Seven is a number of fullness in the scriptures. It's also perfection, but it mostly speaks of fullness, like 7 days in a week. So it's perfectly and fully sealed with seven seals. A seal is a drop of wax, and then a ring is put inside of it, and it's a signet, and it's a seal. It cannot be opened except by the person who it's supposed to be given to. And this one is fully sealed. It's sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, "Who is worthy?" Now, that's an important word. Hold on to that word, worthy. "Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?" But no one in heaven or in earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even peek in it. No one, nobody that's ever been born, no one who's ever lived in all of time was worthy to open it. But no one in heaven and earth was open or even look inside of it. And he says, I wept and I wept. Now hold on to that thought of weeping, because some of you are weeping today. And we need to get your scroll opened. So I wept and I wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, do not weep. Stop weeping. Stop weeping, John. Now look, watch this. Now stay with me. Focus in. See the what? The lion. The lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has triumphed. He is able. Doesn't say he's worthy. Says he's able. He's able to open the scroll and its seven seals. And so I looked and I saw what? I saw what? This is important. Here it is. He's expecting to see a lion like you're expecting to see a lion in the throne. But you know what's in the throne? A beaten up lamb, a scarred up lamb. And I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing, not sitting, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by four living creatures and the elders. He had seven horns. There's that number seven, horns. What does the horns speak of? Horns speak of power and authority. Jesus says, all power and all authority has been given to me, so now you can go. And seven eyes. What do eyes speak of? Eyes speak of wisdom and knowledge and understanding. He knows where you are, what you've done, what you're going to do. He knows everything about you. And the eyes are, which are the seven spirits of God. That's what you've been feeling today. Spirits of God sent into all the earth. And he came and he took. He didn't ask for it. What did he do? He took it. Why? Because it's his. And he's worthy. And he took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. Now, two things I really want you to see here and hone in on. Number one, he's as if he had been slain. He's not slain. And then number two, it's the lamb standing in the midst of the throne, not the lion. Okay. So, here we are. Now, what does all of this mean? Well, what we learn is the Lord has been busy for 2,000 years doing at least this part. This is 25% of the revelation he wants you to have of him, but nobody ever sees him this way. See, in this scroll, if you know what's included in it, you understand what he's been busy doing. Say he's been busy releasing those four horses. Remember the four horses? The white horse, the red horse, the black horse, and the pale horse? They went forth. The seventh seal opened up the seven trumpets, and the seventh trumpet opened up the seven vials that are poured out. And all of this opening up this scroll and this covenant brought him great victory. That's how he got his great victory. So this is what the Lord has been doing while he's sitting in the throne, standing in the center of the universe, standing in the center of the throne. But now I want to identify him. I want to make sure that we know exactly who this lamb is. So in the book of John, chapter 1, verse 29, this is John the Baptist that we're talking about here. The next day, John, this is John the Baptist, saw Jesus. Saw who? Jesus. Saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the what? The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now what we understand, this lamb principle goes all the way back to Abraham, but it's really focused in the book of Exodus. In the book of Exodus, remember that the Lord told Moses to go and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. In the 10th and final plague that came, Moses was told by God to tell the people to go get a lamb for a house, and slay that lamb, and take that lamb's blood and put it on the doorpost of the house. You remember the story? And he says, that precious blood of that lamb put on the house. Delbert, are you saying that lamb's blood was precious? It was to that lamb. And it was to those people. Because that night, the death angel came. And every house that did not have that blood, that precious blood on it, the firstborn died. Death all around. But those that did have that blood on it, the death angel passed over them. Thus the Passover. And that blood becomes precious to you and me as well, because Jesus is the Lamb. And when you get that lamb on, that blood on, that precious blood on your life or on your home, death can be happening all around you. things, bad things could be happening, but it passes over you. That blood is precious. And the thousands and millions and trillions of lambs that have died since that particular time all point and all speak of the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now, why, though, is it so important to God that we see him? An aspect, a part of the revelation that we have of Jesus is of this scarred up lamb, this lamb looking as if it had been slain. What is so important about this? Why should we understand this? We're never taught about this. Why? Why not the lion? Now, the lion just sounds better, doesn't it? I mean, the lion would be better. If I were God, I'd put the lion. Why the lamb? And why a lamb that's, why not a pretty lamb? Why not a lamb that's nice and woolly and, you know, why a scarred up lamb that looks like it's been slain? A lamb with holes in it and scars all over it. And why is that so precious to Jesus that we see him that way? I mean, why couldn't God have done some cosmetic surgery? I mean, if he had power to raise him from the dead, didn't he have power to fix those holes and scratches and bruises and scars? And why didn't he? Is that the glorified body of Jesus? See, you don't see him that way, but you must if you're going to have a revelation of Jesus Christ. And you got to know what the resurrection was about. Why the resurrection? Okay, now, so what is this about? What is this lamb, all this stuff about? Well, first of all, I want us to realize, because how it pertains to you and me. See, inside of you and inside of me is a lion and a lamb. We're in the image of God. And inside of you and I, there is a lion and a lamb. Which one do you resurrect when you go through tough times? Which one do you resurrect to stand in the center of your world, of center of your throne? When you go in through times when people nail you, spear you, scourge you, who do you have resurrected to stand in your throne? See, we can all roar, we can all bite, we can all devour, we can all hurt people. But let me tell you something, it's the Lamb inside of you who is worthy to stand and receive the scroll of your life and to open the seven seals thereof and to bring you great victory. The lion in you is not going to do it. It's that resurrected lamb that looks as if it's been slain. When Jesus, he told all of his disciples, he said, I'm getting up the third day. He said, they're going to kill me, but I'm getting up the third day. And he did. But either they didn't believe him or they forgot. And I just tend to believe they didn't believe him. Yeah, that's kind of what the scriptures say. And the first person that Jesus appeared to was Mary Magdalene. You remember the story. She went to the grave to wash the body of Jesus Christ, and the stones rolled away. He's not there. She's weeping and weeping and crying and crying. Where is what they've done with my Lord? And then the second person, people that he appeared to were these two people walking on the road to Emmaus, 7 miles. They're walking on the road to Emmaus, 7 miles. Jesus appears to them. They don't even recognize him. See, sometimes Jesus will disguise himself from you. He's right beside you. He's talking to you. But you don't recognize him. Why? They were upset as well. They were down. They were discouraged. Jesus had died. He hadn't done what he said he was going to do. They had killed him. He was dead. All their hopes and dreams were over. They weren't happy. And you remember that we read in the book of Revelation in the throne room that John wept and wept because nobody was worthy to open that scroll. He wept and wept until he saw the Lamb. See, it's not until you see the Lamb. Here's what I really want to say. Is that you don't have to be happy for Jesus to show up in your life. You don't even have to believe. They didn't believe. Mary thought that somebody had stolen the body. She didn't believe that he had rose from the dead. And some of you have trouble with that. I don't believe that stuff. That's okay. You don't have to. And some of you are so sad. You've been sad for years and years and years. There's something that you've been sad about. That's okay. You don't have to be happy for Jesus to show up in your life today, right now. And he come up to her, and she was weeping and weeping, and he said, Mary. Mary. And she saw him, and she recognized him, and she said, Rabboni. And these two guys, they're walking, and eventually they're discouraged, and eventually he's going to show himself to them. But here's my point, is you do not have to be happy today. You don't even have to believe this stuff today for Jesus to show up in your life. And I have to believe that he's going to show up in some of your lives today. Now, Stephen Furtick, he has this amazing, amazing series. It's called The 7-Mile Miracle. And I've got you a link there on the bottom of your notes. And I would really love for you to get it. I've only listened to one of them, one of the parts of the series. And it so impacted me and influenced me. I've got his name all the way through our notes whenever he said something that I wanted to reference. And so I got him in there. But I really want you to look at that. And I want to talk about that 7-mile thing just a little bit, and then we're going to move on into something else. But anyway, these guys are walking to Emmaus, and they're sad, and so Jesus shows up, and they don't even recognize him. And some of you are that way. Jesus is walking along with you, and you don't know he's even there. And that's the way he does, because he'll disguise himself sometimes. But I want you to read along with me here on this. As he walks up to them, here's what he says. And he beginning with Moses and the prophets, he, Jesus. Now, this is Jesus doing this. Moses and the prophets, he explained to them. Now, this is Jesus preaching. Jesus is a pretty good preacher, right? When you say Jesus is a pretty good preacher? He began to explain to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. But you know what? He explained all that to them, and they still didn't get it. They still didn't see him. They still didn't know who he was. Here's what I want you to see. You can be the best preacher in the world and still not show people Jesus. He walked with them 7 miles. He opened up the scriptures, and they still didn't recognize him. Then what does it take sometimes for people to see Jesus, for their eyes to be opened and them to experience his presence? What does it take? So he walks with them all of this way. He's 7 miles. He's talking to them about the scriptures from Genesis to Malachi. And he's going to walk on by. They get to the village, and he's just going to walk on by. But they say, hey, come on in. Have some bread with us. Eat with us. So he goes in, and he takes over. He's a guest, but he takes over. And so let me read you the scripture, and then I'll stop in the middle of it and talk. in Luke 24:7, no, in Luke 24:30, it says, when he was at the table with them, he took bread. What did he do with the bread? He took it. He's taken over. He took bread. Let me read the second part so I can go ahead and do it while I'm here. And gave thanks. So he took the bread and he gave thanks. Now, here's what I want you to kind of see. Is Jesus will never twist your arm to get into your life. He's not going to force his way into your house or into your life. He's not going to do that. That's not what he does. But once you invite him in, he's going to take over. I just want you to know, because some of you today may invite him in. And I just want you to know how it works. When he comes in, he wants to take over. Right? And it says that he gave thanks. He had manners. Mary taught him manners. I like that thought. Mary taught him manners. You know, today our kids don't have manners. They are so disrespectful. They are so rebellious. You hardly ever hear one say yes, sir, or yes, ma'am, or no, sir, or no, ma'am, or please, or thank you. We need to teach our children manners. Jesus had manners. And so he took the bread. He took it. And he blessed it. He gave thanks for it. Okay, now we can read on. Now, something begins to happen. They still haven't recognized him yet. And he broke it. That was the tradition. He broke the bread, didn't cut it. He broke it and began to give it to them. Began to give it to them. It was while he's giving it to them, and then something happened. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. What in the world took place? So to help us understand this, I want to relive it just a little bit. So here's Jesus. He takes the bread. He lifts it up and he blesses it. He breaks the bread. And then he stretches out his hands and he gives it to them. What do you suppose they saw? What do you suppose opened their eyes? What do you suppose that it was that all of a sudden they knew who he was? It was his scars, where the wounds were, where the nails had been. You see, as he began to give it to them, their eyes were open. There's something about scars that have a story. There's something about scars that verify who you are. There's something about scars. You see, I can walk with people all day long. I can open up the book of Revelation to them. I can tell them all about scriptures, and I sit for hours and hours writing emails to people asking about stuff and asking about this, and I've spent time with people, and their eyes are never open, and they never really see Jesus. You see, they'll never see him until they see scars. His and mine. Scars make me authentic. When you know I bleed, when you know I hurt, when you know I'm not perfect, I can really tell you about Jesus. I can show you him. I can help you get your eyes open so that you can see him. The church is so full of hypocrites because they want to project themselves as being so perfect. No, they've got scars. We've all got long sleeves on today. But if we roll those sleeves up, I'd find scars. We've all been hurt. We've all been wounded. But we want to cover them up. And so what Jesus did is he disappeared. They saw him. Has he ever done that with you? Has Jesus ever just disappeared on you? You know, you got him in a corner. You got him figured out. You got the formula. He's answering prayers for you. Then poof, he's gone. Where did you go, Jesus? And he's not answering any more prayers. And it doesn't mean he's forsaken you. What it does mean is you got to go find him again. And that's what they did. They got up and went back to Jerusalem. They knew that's where he was going to be. And that's a lot of times what we won't do. We expect him to come find us. You know, come be with us. No. We got to get up and go find him again. So, I want you to see something here that I think is so amazing. So he showed him. He showed these guys his hands. So it's the same day now. It's the same day. It's that evening. And Jesus is back in Jerusalem. And now he's going to appear to his disciples. And there's 11 of them left. It didn't work out real well for Judas. And there's 10 of them together. And so Jesus wants to go see them. So he goes, and I want to read you that part because it links in with what we're talking about here today. It's in John chapter 20 and verse 19. It says, on the evening of that first day, same day, that day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. Okay, I'm going to talk to you just a second. You could take it down for just a minute. Fear will always lock the doors of your heart. What we want to do is we want to lock ourselves in because people are hurting us and wounding us and they're spearing us and scourging us. And so we want to lock the doors to protect ourselves. But what we end up doing is locking people out. And by locking people out, we lock God out. We lock God out. And what do you mean, Delbert? Well, Jesus was asked one day, what is the greatest commandment? And he says, well, there's two. You can't separate them. He says, the first one is you got to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and soul. Okay, that's the first one. But the second one is you got to love people. And if you're locking people out, you're locking God out because you can't have one without the other. And so a lot of you today have locked hearts. Locked doors. You've locked yourself away from the things of people and so also from the things of God. Now, I'm praying today, and this is what's going to happen today, I pray, is that Jesus is going to pick the lock of your heart, and he's going to walk through the wall of your heart, and he's going to show himself to be real and valid. He's not an imposter. He's going to walk in there, and he's going to do some stuff because he wants to show you his scars. So, fear of the Jews. Where am I? Okay. The doors were locked for fear of the Jews. And Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace. Now you gotta, here they are in these locked, behind these locked doors. And he walks through the walls or picks the lock or whatever that he does. And there he is and says, peace. Now how much peace would you have? So what does he do? They're not recognizing him. So what does he do to verify that it's him, number one, and to also bring them peace? Verse 20. After he said this, after he said peace, he showed them. What did he show them? His hands and his side. He showed them the places where the wounds were. He showed them his scars. And they believed, and the disciples were overjoyed. And they said, "Our Lord." Now I want you to see something very, very important here. Jesus is not ashamed of his scars. Jesus is not ashamed of where the nails were. He is not ashamed of where that spear went. He is not ashamed of the scars on his back. Jesus is not ashamed. And so it's Resurrection Day, and we're talking about that. And I'm wondering about some of us here. Where are you wounded? Who's wounded you? Where are you wounded? And are you ashamed of those scars? Are you ashamed of those wounds? See, so many Christians are just imposters, impersonating a Christian. We want to show the presence of God in our lives by our successes, by our money, by the things we have, by the blessings of God on our lives. That's how we want to show the presence of God. But you know how Jesus showed his presence and showed his successes? By his scars, by those things that had happened to him. He wasn't ashamed of them. Here, take a look. See, it's how we handle the wounds of life. It's how we handle the spears and the nails of life. It's how we handle those things that life give us and people give us that really tell the story of who we are, whether we're really successful or not. That's what tells the true story. See, Christianity is not cosmetic surgery. Christianity is not God coming and fixing all your wounds and healing and removing all your scars. In fact, what it is and what Jesus came into your life to do and comes into your life to do is reveal your wounds, hoping you'll turn your wounds into scars and give you peace, so that you can show others your scars and bring them peace. One of the disciples was not there. There were 11 left, and 10 were there, and one wasn't. And I want to read about him now. He's Tommy, or Thomas. And let's talk about him. In John chapter 20, verse 24, it says, "Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples, the other ten, told him, 'We have seen the Lord.'" Now, before we look at that rest of that verse, I just want to say something to you. We have seen the Lord. Now, these are 10 of his best buddies. He has spent day and night with these guys for three and a half years. Right? Now, you would think, would you not, that they're telling him about Jesus, that Jesus was love, we've seen the Lord, that he would say, "Woohoo! Hallelujah! Glory be to God! I wished I had been there. I missed it. Oh, man, I hate that. But yay, he's risen! Hallelujah!" That's not what happened. We're going to read it. But here's my point, is your best buddies can tell you about Jesus, and you still won't believe it. You know what you got to see? You got to see scars. You got to see something real and valid. Let me read that to you now. "But he," Tommy said, said to them, "unless I see the nail marks, unless I see where the nails were in his hands and put my finger where the nails were." Now, I love that thought, where the nails were. Not where the nails are, but where the nails were. T.D. Jakes could take that one little phrase and preach for a couple of hours on that. Where the nails were. See, we want to tell people where the nails are, because it never becomes a scar. It's always a wound. where the nails were, and put my hand into his side. My goodness, Tommy. And put my hand into his side, I'm not going to believe it. I'm not going to believe it. Now, I really, really like that. You see, your wounds speak much louder than your words. You can tell your best buddies all about Jesus. They're not going to believe it until they see scars, his and yours. Your words speak so much louder than your wounds speak so much louder than your words. You see, we all have that. We all have wounds. We all have scars on our lives. We all do. And how much louder they speak. You see, it's just amazing to me that how we deal with this. So let's see what happens in this. I want to read the next verse to us. John chapter 20 and verse 26. It says, a week later. Now this is a disciple. A week later. Why did Jesus make him wait a week? Why? Has Jesus ever made you wait? More than a week, more than 7 days, right? More than 7 weeks, more than 7 months, maybe 7 years. You see, there's a waiting aspect to God. Made him wait. He shows up. And his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace. Peace. Verse 27. Then he said to Tommy, hey, Tommy, come here. I hear you want to see my scars. I hear you want to check them out. I hear you're interested to see if I'm real. Come here, Tommy. Put your finger right here. And see my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. So what caused Tommy to stop doubting and to believe? Scars. Places where wounds were. Thomas said what? My Lord and my God. People need to see scars. Why is Jesus a lamb looking as if it had been slain? Because that's what people have to see to know you're valid, to know you're real, to know you're authentic. That's what they have to see. And here's the interesting thing, and I'm wanting to finish up. So here's an interesting thing. Jesus allowed him to see and inspect his scars, his wounds, where the wounds were. I mean, now think about this. This had only happened a short time before, and he's inviting Tommy to come and put his fingers and hands and I mean that ought to hurt. Jesus wasn't going, oh, stop, Thomas, don't you know it? That hurts, man. It's still bleeding. Look at it. That's not what he did, is it? Why? And here's what I really, really want us to see. See, even Jesus goes through a bad situation and comes out with wounds and scars. Because we all get them. But there's a big difference in a wound and a scar. A wound says it's still bleeding. A wound says it's still hurting. A wound says if it hasn't healed in a proper amount of time, it's infected. Something's wrong. And some of us here today, we've got a wound. And it's not healed in years. Something's wrong. A scar tells a story. A scar doesn't hurt. A scar has a story with it. I can talk about the scar, but I really don't want to talk about this wound. I want this wound to heal. Christians are so flaky. So many of them. That we say, we're blessed, we're healed. Well, if you're healed and you're so blessed, then why are you so touchy? Why is it that every time this person's name is mentioned, you go off? Why is it every time this particular situation comes up, you get mad? Because it's not healed. Because you haven't forgiven it. You haven't forgiven it so it can heal. It will never heal until it's forgiven. Jesus hanging on the cross. It's in your notes. I'll just say it because I'm wanting to get done. Hanging on the cross, what does he say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what? What they do. What they do. Not what they did. What they do. While they were doing it, he forgave them. Now listen. When somebody's nailing me, when somebody's poking and spearing me and beating me, when somebody's giving me, you know, when they're trying to crucify me, I say, Father, they know exactly what they're doing. And when I forgive, I will forgive. But I want to fester a little bit, you know. I just wanted to get just a little infected, you know. I know I got to forgive it. But it's not going to heal until I do. What if we forgave while it was happening? It never would hurt. It never would hurt. And let me tell you what, forgiveness is not God doing cosmetic surgery on you and removing your scars. That's not what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is not denial. It happened. There's a scar there. It happened. That's not what forgiveness is saying, I'm healed from it. It doesn't hurt anymore. Oh, I remember it. I can tell you the story about it. But it doesn't hurt anymore. I'm going on. I'm still not nailed to that thing. It's still not shoving it into me. I'm going on. Yes, 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 yes. You were divorced. Yes, you were. But don't tell people about the divorce. Tell them what God did for you, how he did something good for you. You got something better now. Yeah, that it wounded you. It scarred you. Yes, yes, yes. You went bankrupt. It was a wounding, embarrassing time in your life. But look what God's done for you. Show them the scar, not the wound. Yeah, you got a bad doctor's report. You really did. It was bad. But show them that God is healing you. You got laid off from work. You really did. The pink slip, the whole thing. You hadn't done anything. You got laid off from work. But show people how God is providing for you and taking care of you. Yes, you were abused. Yes, you were mistreated. Yes, you were betrayed. Yes, people talked about you and turned people against you. It all happened. But don't show them the nails. Show them the the nails were. Don't show them the spear. Don't talk about people. Don't keep that thing festered up. Show them that it's not holding you there now. It's not stopping you now. And you're a real Christian. You're not an imposter playing a Christian. Show people the scars, and they will see Jesus, the Lamb, looking as if it had been slain in you. Two quick points. First of all, Jesus needed those nails. He needed that spear. He needed those scars. Without those, he would have not been successful. Without those, there would have been no redemption. There would have been no forgiveness of sin. As bad as it was, and Jesus is proud. He's proud of his scars. You and I, we need, as bad as it sounds, we need our scars. We need those wounds. Here's why. Because you'll never be successful without them. Your wounds and your scars make you who you are today. It's the tough times of life that make you and mold you and bring you into success and direct your life, not the easy times. But you got to forgive them, and you can't let them keep holding you there. And the last one, see, we've all had scars, we've all had wounds, we've all experienced these things, we've all had this stuff happen to us. But also, we've all inflicted nails and spears and scourges on others. In fact, some of you right now, you got both pockets full of nails, and your pocketbook's full of nails, and you got a spear in both hands, and you can't wait until you can use them. They hurt you, and you're going to get them back. It doesn't work that way. You see, if you want your wounds to heal, you got to forgive. It's just going to be a mess. Infected, festering from now on until you deal with it and forgive it. So why? Why is Jesus a lamb looking as if he had been slain? Because he wants to show us the importance of scars. It's when people see that they change. Why? What's he been doing for 2,000 years? He's been running this universe. He's been the Lion of Man, the man walking in the church as the Son of Man. He's been the Lion that's looking as if he had been slain. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he is the husband of the Lamb's wife, the husband of lambs. He's the husband of the church. That's what he's been doing. But for you and for me, it's about the scars today. It's about forgiveness today. Who's wounded you? Who's nailed you? Who has speared you? Who have you wounded? Who have you nailed? Who have you speared? See, it's the Lamb that's worthy to take the scroll and stand in the center of your life and bring you victory. But it's not the Lion, it's the Lamb. Let's pray. Father, thank you for our time together. We thank you, Lord God, for your goodness and your mercy and your kindness and helping us and being with us today. We love you, Lord. Now, I just want to ask you, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, praise Him, you can stay down there for right now. I just want to ask you, while your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, some of you, at one time in your life, you're real close to the Lord. You felt His presence, and then something happened. Maybe you got mad at church people, and that happens a lot. Somebody hurt you and wounded you, and you just left it. Well, I'm not doing that anymore. Or something happened in your life. You got busy, but anyway, you drifted away. But you know that Jesus has been picking at your lock, and He's walking in through that wall of your heart. And what He's wanting to do right now is have a relationship with you. So if that's you today, and you just want to get back with the Lord, I'm not going to ask you to come down here or stand or nothing like that. I just want you where you're sitting, with everybody, nobody looking but me. I just want you to raise your hand and say, yes, I do. I want to feel His presence again. I want to be with Him again. I want to feel that again. If that's you, would you just slip your hand up for me and just let me pray for you? I see your hand back there. I see a hand right there. Another hand right here in the front. Any more? Great. That's great. That's wonderful. All right, now, just one more thing. And again, I'm not going to ask you to come down here. But maybe you've never received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And you know it's time. You're tired of running. You're going to invite Him in. You're tired of fighting all the mess, going through all the stuff. You're going to invite Him in. You know He's going to want to take over. But I promise you, your life will be so good when He does. Maybe that's you. You've just never received Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. But right now, right today, you're saying, I want to. I want to tell people about my scars. I've got a bunch of them. And I want to tell people about my scars, because I want to give them peace. I want them to know they can make it. I got some stories. Maybe that's you. If that's you, you've never received Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. Right where you're sitting, just me seeing. Would you slip your hand up and say, pray for me. Pray for me. Pray for me. I see your hand. I see it. Yes. Okay. Father, thank you for this wonderful resurrection day. Praise the name. You come up now. I just thank you so much for allowing me the opportunity and the blessing to get to share with your people, your precious, precious people. I ask you, Lord God, to bless every single person here. I ask you to bless them simply because they sit here and listen to me. I just thank you, Lord God, for them, each one of them, and I ask you to be with us all, and I ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you give the Lord a shout and a hand clap and just say thank you? Praise the Lord. And the Lord is risen! All right.